Hey guys, welcome back. Welcome back to another English lesson. Yeah, so a pretty much awaited video. Here I have 2019 JNU's question paper. Even before I start analyzing 2019 question paper of JNU, I would like to first of all tell you all that till 2018 JNU was only asking subjective questions. But from 2019, they changed their pattern completely and they started asking objective questions. I did first of all like you to take a look of how question paper in 2019 looked like. If you look at this question paper, question number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8, pretty much based on your objective learning. But if you start looking at questions, especially from question number 9, you see a big paragraph, a paragraph followed by a question, and the question followed by four options. Yeah, so 9, 10, 11, pretty much based on your subjective learning. Question number 12, 13, 14, again, pretty much based on your subjective learning. 15, 16, 17, again, based on your subjective learning. 18, 19, 20, very much based on your subjective learning. 21, 22, 23 again, 24 to 26 again, then 27 to 30 again, same stuff, 31 to 33 again. 31, 32 of course pretty much based on the paragraph, but 33 is an absolute objective question. Right, so before I begin solving or analyzing 2019 question paper of JNU, I did first of all like you to understand that if you are solely relying on history of English literature books, please forget your dreams of cracking into universities like Delhi University, JNU, Punjab University or Pune University, because your objective learning is solely not going to help you. Your question papers, you know, these kind of question papers, especially from these important central and state universities, they are completely based on your subjective learning, and I've repeated that numerous times in my other videos as well. Right? Okay, before I begin with my video, I would be putting the link in my description box. You may check out the link. I've published a video before previously where I have talked about how you have to go about solving these passage based questions. So maybe you can click on that link, or you can click on the link of my other videos also in relation to MA English entrance program, and check out the do's and don'ts of studying for the PG entrances for these universities specifically. Right, coming back to the question paper here. Yeah, I was saying that if you are solely relying on history of English literature books, you will land yourself in a big soup. Okay, now if you look at question number 1, you see it's pretty much based on your objective learning. Question number 2, pretty much based on your objective learning. Question number 3, idea of a university, the collected lectures dating from 1852 onwards and published in 73 by its A. John Henry Newman. Okay, what do we see again? Again, a question based on your objective learning. So John Henry Newman is the right answer. A Vision by W.B. Yeats is a book of mystical philosophy. Then question number 5, which of the following was not published in 1930? It's D, My Experiments with Truth. Again, a question based on your objective learning. Then if you look at question number 6, which of the following novels is not written in Stream of Consciousness? Look at how important Stream of Consciousness is. You don't even need to think about it, because Stream of Consciousness, when you talk about Stream of Consciousness, we have only three important pioneers. It's James Joyce, D.H. Lawrence and Virginia Woolf. So absolutely, we're not gonna mark Sound and the Fury or Mrs. Dalloway here. The correct answer is gonna be The Old Man and the Sea. Which of the following, again, a question based on your objective learning. Then, question number 7, which of the following develops into rasa? Now, this is one hell of a question. I won't at all say that this is based on your objective learning, because if you don't know that rasa gets divided into three parts, and what are those three parts, if you don't know their identification, if you don't know this entire theory of Indian aesthetics, you won't be able to solve this question at all. Okay, but the answer here is Thai Bhav, and this is something this question is based on a complete theory, and this is why I keep on saying that you cannot crack entrances like these just relying on history of English literature books. You have to do a lot more. For students who are not from this background, or who haven't done English, or who had not studied English basically in their graduation, or who have no idea about how English literature as a subject works. And also for a lot of students who are coming from these random private universities, now for those your students also, solving questions like these is a big deal. Okay, so you cannot just rely on any XYZ thing and think that you can pass the examination, because it's a hard nut to crack. So you need a lot of practice, and question papers like these, they check your years of reading. Okay, years of reading, years of your effort into the subject. So if you don't know how you have to go about studying English literature as a subject on a whole, you cannot solve exams, or you cannot crack these exams, okay, exams of JNE or DU. You need to put in a lot of effort, a lot of reading, a lot of effort goes into passing these examinations. Okay, so question number 7 is based on a complete theory called Indian aesthetics. I won't of course be going about doing this theory separately with you, because it would take me a week to complete this theory, so no, not at all. So but the answer is Thai Bhav here, for any student who wants to know the answer. So now question number 8, again, I'm not gonna discuss this question. This is something you should be knowing, or you should have studied in your graduation. If you don't know what personification, simile, metaphor or things like these are, if you don't even have any idea about these figures of speech, no trainer is going to teach you that. Okay, nobody in your master's program, no professor in your master's program, if you're gonna get yourself into universities like this, no professor is gonna teach you things like these, because these are ABC things of English literature. So I'm not at all gonna discuss this, because everything from question number 1 to question number 8 is based on your objective learning. If you've done your objective learning, if you're good at just learning things, you can of course check mark the right answers. But yeah, coming back to the essence of the question paper, everything from question number 9, I personally believe it's really really based on your years of reading. It's something that's not going to come like this. Okay, it's really based on a lot of effort and a lot of reading. If you're a good reader, if you read a lot, only then you can crack the exams of these universities. And not just random reading, okay, here I mean the real reading, understanding the core of things. If you cannot understand the essence or understand the core of these passages, again you won't be able to pull out the rope. Okay, so it's really really important that you understand the core of these passages. Now if you want to understand how you have to go about solving passages like these, because 1 to 10 or 100 passages will also not do you anything, and trust me on this, they're not giving you these passages from anywhere. Okay, they're all coming out from these important books. If you read a lot, if you know how you have to go about doing this, because there's a certain way of studying for this entrance examination. It's not like you pick up any XYZ thing and believe that you will be able to do it. Okay, number one thing. So it takes up a lot of effort. Okay, again and again, I have this tendency of repeating things, but I don't do fake stuff with my students. I'm really really honest with my students, and if there is a certain thing in which I believe, I'm gonna say that thing 100 times so that it's there imbibed in your mind and you know that this is the reality, this is the truth. So I don't want like to keep my students under a fake blanket. So yeah, coming back to question number 9, what I was trying to say is that you really need to understand the core and the essence of these passages. Now I've already provided you the link down there. You can check out the link and try understanding. It's an hour's video. You can try understanding how you have to go about dealing with passages like these. But again and again, I'm saying a lot of effort goes into it, a lot of reading, and there's a way to do these things. Okay, way to solve, way to read, way to understand, way to analyze from where these things are gonna come. So yeah, and it's something that you cannot understand if you don't know the basics of English literature. So I've seen a lot of students mercilessly bonkering their heads on these history of English literature books, ending up with nothing. And it's so unfortunate to see students wasting their time on that, because even if you're doing history things, you know, there's a way to attempt those things. There's a way to go about doing this, those things. There's a way to filter, and there's a way to understand what you have to do or what you have to eliminate. A lot of stuff, a lot of effort goes into that. So, but coming back to question number 9, let's look at these questions first. Question number 9 says, where does the essence of the tragic lie? So we understand that they maybe are talking about tragic. Then they're asking us next question, the writer here offers. Okay, so maybe we're gonna try finding the basic idea behind the paragraph. Okay, looking at the question, let's try reading the paragraph. It says, the inarticulacy. Now, what is inarticulacy, first of all? Again, all those weak vocab students, you will be filtered out, you know, when you are reading these. They are deliberately doing this with you, right? Deliberately, they're doing it with you so that they can check. They want to know if you really read at home, okay? If you really do a lot of reading. So, what is inarticulacy? Now, first of all, if you don't know what inarticulacy is, you will not be able to understand. If you're stuck at any word, again, you're gone, right? So your vocab also should be up to the point. What is inarticulacy? It's the inability to speak with clarity. Okay, when you are unable to speak with clarity, that is what we call inarticulacy. Okay, so if you know this, now you will be able to understand the passage. The inarticulacy of the tragic hero, which distinguishes the main figure in Greek tragedy from all his successors, is one of the foundation stones of the theory of tragedy. So we come to know that the writer maybe is talking about some basic idea, something really, really important, which ends up becoming the foundation stone of the theory of the tragedy. And so we come to know what, now if you don't understand what is that foundation stone, again you are stuck. Okay, you first of all need to understand what is the foundation stone that he's talking about. The foundation stone is the inarticulacy of the tragic hero. Then, for this is the mark of self. Self is my favorite word. I'm doing my PhD on self, literally. So anywhere, you know, if you get words like these, where, you know, words like these that define the core, that define the essence, that define the heart of the passage, immediately mark them. For this is the mark of the self, the seal of its greatness and the token of its weakness alike. It is silent. Okay, this is what the writer is trying to explain us. The tragic hero has only one language. Okay, we are still trying to find out the essence of the passage now. The tragic hero has only one language that is completely proper to him. That is what? Silence. Okay, this is one language of the tragic hero, that is silence. It has been so from the very beginning. Okay, the tragic devised itself, the artistic form of the drama, precisely so as to be able to present silence. See, again, he's talking about silence. So maybe silence is something positively connected or positively connotated to the tragic hero. In his silence, the hero burns the bridges connecting him to God. Okay, so silence is equals to self. First of all, tragic hero is equals to silence. Silence is equals to self, and self or silence is equals to his connection with the God and the world. Okay, okay. So we understand that silence or self of the tragic hero is equals to what? Is equals to connection of the tragic hero with God and the world. Elevates himself above the realm of personality. Okay, elevates. Now here you need to understand, the moment this writer is talking about some elevation, he is shifting his ideas towards a different direction. Now he is no more talking about silence and self is equals to the tragic hero's connection with God. A lot of times it happens, if you are unable to distinguish between these ideas, you will again be stuck in your passage. A lot of times it happens that in single passage you have four ideas running, three ideas running, five ideas running, six ideas running. What will you do if you are unable to identify the separation of ideas? You will again be stuck. So there we need to understand that separation of ideas is very important. Here, till here, he was talking about silence in relation to silence of the tragic hero in relation to his connection with God. But now he shifts his idea and he says, elevates himself above the realm of personality. Now, the moment we talk about personality, now this is something that nobody on this earth can help you if you do not have literary sense. Now, I keep on saying this, that literary sense is very important in order to be able to crack the entrance exam of these universities. And they're actually, honestly, they're checking your literary sense. Now, if you don't know, if you haven't done any reading any time of your life, you won't be able to identify that this personality is something in relation to materialism, and self is a much, of course, it's a much bigger, it's a much elevated thing, something that you cannot decipher, something that you cannot touch. It's something of a meta quality. Right. So the moment we read something from this line, now this is just an example here in front of us, you might get something else. It's just like math, a formula. You'll be getting something else now in your 2020 question paper. What will you do? What will you do if you cannot distinguish between these ideas? So the separation of ideas is very important. I'm again and again saying, so please focus on that while you're reading these passages. Please try separating, try filtering. Elevates himself above the realm of personality, which in speech defines itself against others and individualizes itself, and so enters the icy loneliness of the self. Why is the writer saying this? Because this tragic hero is unable to communicate with the materialistic world because of the deep realization that he has for his own self, and it is his self that helps him win over the world. It is his self that helps him realize his own sense of tragedy. Yeah, so I love this passage, honestly. I love things like these, things like self and silence. So yeah, if you don't have that literary sense of understanding it, you won't be able to define the two separate things that the writer here is talking about. The writer is talking about two things. He is talking about the self. Number one, the self is something, self is very much, you know, let's say self is a very different aspect of the tragic hero, and the personality which the writer is trying to explain us is not maybe a very big part of his personality. It's something maybe related to his materialism, but that does not occupy a larger space in his life. What is he trying to say? That the self is of more importance, and it is only because of his self that he is able to realize what is good for him, or that he is able to realize his own sense of tragedy, and this is why he ends up becoming a tragic hero. The self knows nothing other than itself, its loneliness is absolute. Okay, so we understood that the writer here is talking about two important things. He's, number one, he's talking about tragic hero. Then number two, he's talking about the self and the silence of the tragic hero. Number three, he's talking about the personality, something in relation to personality, but that personality is not in sync with self. Self is something else and personality is something else. Personality is here is related to worldly pleasures or maybe related to materialism. But he's trying to focus that for a tragic hero, the writer is trying to focus that for a tragic hero, self is more important because this self helps him understand his own sense of tragedy. And this self consists of what? Consists of loneliness. That is absolute. That is ultimate. That is for him the end of the world. Theek hai? Understood? Now let's try looking at the questions. Question number 9, it says, where does the essence of the tragic lie? Now, when you have these questions in front of you, do not panic, okay? There's no need of hurry. Just read these options nicely, okay? Relax and read these questions nicely. A, because the moment, you know, if you're in hurry and if you're just trying to do this reading randomly, again, you will be stuck. Just read, not just this random reading, but again, reading through yourself, actually taking in, pouring in, that is important. Okay, option number A, it says, in the tragic, hero is not being able to be a self. Oh, such a foolish option. We're not gonna mark this at all. Okay, I'm not gonna say which one is right now, which one is wrong. We're first of all gonna read the options. Option number B, it says, in the tragic, hero is not being able to be a personality. Option number C, in the tragic, hero is not being able to connect to the world and God in speech. Option number D, none of the above. So again, let's go back to the question and let's try understanding the question again. It says that where does the essence of the tragic lie? They're asking us where does the core or the basic idea of the tragic lie? What is the basic idea? We need to identify that. When we look at question number A, it says, in the tragic, hero is not being able to be a self. This is an absolutely wrong, most foolish option. We were again and again talking about that tragic hero's self is more important to him because his self is something that helps him realize his own sense of tragedy. So in any case, you're not going to mark this option. Now let's look at option number B. It says, in the tragic, hero is not being able to be a personality. Okay, now we can consider this because here the writer says elevates himself above the realm of personality. But again, we look at question number C, we'll see if there are other better options than option B. In the tragic, hero is of course not being able to connect to the world and God in speech. Hero is not being able to connect to the world and God in speech. Now this again, okay, this might be the right answer. None of the above is absolutely wrong because we still think that we can have one or the other answer, either option number B or option number C. Okay, if you look at your passage again, if you go back, what does it say? I'll mark it for you here. The tragic device itself, the artistic form of the drama, precisely so as to be able to present silence. In his silence, the hero burns the bridges connecting him to God and the world. Elevates himself above. Now, these are the core lines of this passage. Now, if you look at option number C, from the perspective of these lines, in the tragic, hero is not being able to connect to the world and God in speech. Right? Now, this very word speech gives us the answer. Hero here is connecting with what? Hero here is connecting with silence. Look at the passage again. What does it say? In his silence, the hero burns the bridges connecting him to God. Now look at option number C here. What does it say? In the tragic, hero is not being able to connect the world and God in speech. Of course, he's not connecting with God or he's not connecting with the world through speech. How is he connecting himself through? He's using this entire idea. We're talking about this entire idea of self. Silence again and again. He's connecting through silence. And this is what they're saying. Not to be, they've used to the word not. Look at this question. This is how they're going to make it difficult for you. By using the words yes and not. Yes or no. So if you don't identify that you have not here, you again you'll get your answer wrong because a lot of students, you know, will mark option number B, but that's not the right answer because if you look at the strengthening, option number C is in any case a much better answer than option number B. Because hero, of course, is not, they're saying, it's absolutely right. See, he's not being able to connect to the world and God in speech. So how is he connecting? He's connecting through silence. Right. And if you look at not being able to be a personality, of course, this is also very wrong in a sense because it says elevates himself above the realm of personality. So personality is not very important for this tragic hero. What is important is his silence. And option number C very much favors the silence of the tragic hero. So we're gonna go with option number C. Check mark option number C. It's the right answer in any case. Now, question number 10, it says the writer here offers a neoclassical theory of tragedy. Now, if you don't know what is a neoclassical theory, I'm not going to explain you in this lecture. Of course, it's not a neoclassical theory. Okay, Marxist conception of theory. All of my students who know, we've studied Marxism in class, we know that it cannot be Marxist in any way. A psychoanalytic conception of tragedy. Not in a sense, because in the entire passage they keep on talking about self, silence, and again things in relation to personality. But yes, option number D is the right answer. They're not talking about any of these things mentioned here. So we're gonna go with option number D. Theek hai, now coming back to the next question, that is, this passage argues that tragic is an experience of selfhood, right? Okay. Option number B, personality arises in speech community. Okay. We should think of selfhood in distinction from personality, or option number D, all of the above. Okay, let's try analyzing all of these options one by one. If you look at option number A, tragic is the experience of selfhood. Yes, okay, they are talking about self, so very much in favor of the passage. Personality arises in speech community. Okay, wherever there is personality, there is speech. Okay, and we had the writer talking about personality not a part of the tragic hero, because that is something. That is not of much importance to a tragic hero, because in any case his self and silence is a much greater thing. So here they are saying that personality arises in speech community. Of course, very much in favor of the passage. Option number C, we should think of selfhood in distinction from personality. Yes, this is why we marked option number C in our last question. Personality and self, two different separate ideas. We were talking about that. I was screaming at the top of my voice again and again and telling you that these are two different things. So yeah, option number D, all of the above. Yes, so we're gonna mark all of the above here. All of the above is the right answer. We're gonna check mark option number D because your question is talking about selfhood also. It's also talking about personality being a part of speech community. It's also talking about selfhood in distinction from personality. So yes, we're gonna mark D because A, B, C, all of these options are right. They're all in favor of the passage that we have. So yeah, we're done solving questions 9, 10, 11. I hope it's pretty much clear how you have to go about solving these passages, but yes, I'll be taking all of these questions one by one. All right, now coming back to question number 12, it says, but more joyful the joy. Okay, the more pure the sadness slumbering within it. So in the first few lines, we see that the writer is talking about joy and pain. Okay, more pure the sadness. Till here, he's only talking about sadness. It's not completely pain, maybe. Now, the deeper the sadness, the more summoning the joy resting within it. Sadness and joy play into each other. Important line that explains all of these three lines, that sadness and joy, they're alike. So sometimes you might experience a lot of joy in your life. A lot of times we do experience a lot of sadness or pain in our lives. So both the things go hand in hand. The play itself, which attunes the two by letting the remote be near and rear be remote, is pain. This is why both highest joy and deepest sadness. This is why both highest joy and deepest sadness are painful each in its way. Now, but pain so touches the spirit of mortals that the spirit receives its gravity from pain. What lovely lines. That gravity, first of all, reading it for you, that gravity keeps mortals with all their wavering at rest. Wavering here is doubts at rest in their being. The spirit which answers to pain, the spirit attuned by pain and to pain, is melancholy. See, in the first few lines, in the initial lines, they were talking about sadness, and then they started talking about pain, and now pain turning into real melancholy. Now see, look at the transition, look at the transition of the writer talking about sadness, then he talks about pain, and once he's done talking with pain, he transforms his entire psychology behind pain into melancholy. It can depress the spirit, but it can also lose its burdensomeness and lets its secret breath nestle into the soul, bestow upon it the jewel which arrays it in the precious relation to the word, and with this raiment shelters it. Okay, we're done reading. Let's look at the questions. First of all, the writer shows here that, again, maybe the writer wants to ask your basic idea. The writer here offers, again, something in relation to your basic idea. Look at the kind of questions that they are framing, right? They want to confuse you. Both the questions look alike. And now you have to look at your options and then delve deep into your analysis. Again, the separation here works. Melancholy here is understood as, okay, again, we have four options. So we have three questions in relation to this passage. Theek hai, chalo, let's try understanding it. But more, okay, we're done understanding this much, that pain and joy are alike. If you have pain in your life, you'll also have happiness. So if we have corona right now, corona will also go away at a point in time. So this is what maybe the writer is talking about. But let's read the other set of important lines. But pain so touches the spirit of mortals that the spirit receives its gravity from pain. A lot of times it happens, you know, you see these writers, you see these poets, they end up writing these beautiful, lovely poems, and then suddenly when we read them, we're like, wow, and this wah comes out from your heart. So how does that come out? How does that come out? Why? Because you know, you see so much pain in the writing, you see so much pain in the poems, and once you see that, once you read that, you're like, oh my God, from where is this coming? God's sake, you cannot write things like this if you've never fallen in love with somebody, or if you haven't, you know, experienced pain like this, right? So this is what the writer is talking about in these two lines. But pain so touches the spirit of mortals that the spirit, your soul is touched by your pain. Okay, your soul is touched by your pain, and when your soul is touched by the pain, you understand the gravity of it, you understand the weight of the pain, you understand what it is to feel like, you know, to feel the pain in your heart. This is what the writer is talking about, that gravity keeps mortals with all their wavering at rest in their being. Which gravity? The gravity of experiencing your pain. That gravity. Now if you don't understand, if you're not able to sync your lines with one another, again, you'll fall out. That gravity keeps mortals with all their wave. All of your doubts are put at rest the moment your soul realizes its depth. Depth of what? Depth of the pain that you are feeling. The spirit which answers to pain, the spirit who is answering, the spirit is responding to the pain. This is what he's talking about now in these lines. Yeah, spirit is equals to pain. Your spirit is touched by your pain. It's only when your pain touches your spirit, you understand what your pain is like. Okay, the spirit which answers to pain, the spirit attuned by pain and to pain. Oh my God, what lovely lines. Is melancholy. Yeah, it can depress the spirit, but it can also, a lot of times, what does it say? You feel a lot of pain in your life. Let's say something happens to you, you feel a lot of pain in relation to it. Okay, it can depress you, but at the same time, what do? We feel a lot of pain. Somebody hurts us. We sit in our room and we cry wholeheartedly. So what does it take away from you? It takes away the burden, right? It happens or not. So this is what the writer is saying. Simple as that. It can depress the spirit, but it can also lose its burdensomeness and let its secret breath nestle into the soul. What happens? You cry, you open your door, you come out. What happens? You take a deep breath and you feel, oh my God, now I'm feeling so light. Right? This is what the writer is trying to say in these lines. Understanding? Understanding with your own pain. It's only when you feel it, you understand it. So I like making my students feel all of these things. Bestow upon it the jewel which Ares. Now these are some tricky lines. Okay, now these lines require your literary sense. A lot of literary, of course, the above lines also, but these are way difficult than the other set of lines that you have in this passage. Bestow upon it the jewel which Ares. It in the precious relation to the word. Precious relation to the word. Precious relation to the word. What do you think it could be? Word, letters, sentences, poems, poets, writers. Understood? What is the writer trying to talk about? He's talking about the pain that you read in the poems. He's talking about the pain you read in their writings. You understood? If you're feeling that these are easy, you might be feeling that these are easy because I'm explaining you these, but if you will sit alone and try solving these, you'll find it really hard. So it's really, really important you understand how you have to go about doing these. Okay, you have to really, really feel these passages in your heart. If you don't feel, if you can't feel, then it's a problem. Literature is all about feeling things. If you cannot feel your literature, if you cannot feel the writings, you're stuck. And it's not random Chetan Bhagat writing, okay? It's a very important passage from one of these important books. All of these are from these important works. Yeah. Bestow upon it the jewel which Ares it in the precious relation to the word and with its raiment shelters it. Okay, okay. I'll explain you these lines. I know a lot of you won't be able to understand it. See, the writer, of course, he was talking about pain, and he was talking about pain in context of spirit. How when your spirit is touched by your pain, only then you realize what your pain is like, right? Understood this much? Then he says, you know, this jewel that he's talking about your pain coming out in the form of your writings. That looks like a jewel that is no less than a costly stone, okay? That is no less than a costly diamond, which Ares it in, Ares means collection, Ares it in the precious relation to the word, and you bind your pain word by word in the form of poem, and with this raiment shelters it. Raiment means you put a dress to it, you cover it, and you hide your pain, but it still never goes away, okay? All of these important poets, all of these important writers, I'm not talking about Instagram poets here. I'm talking about these important writers. I'm talking about poets from 20th century, 21st century, writing about their pain, writing about the pain that their spirit has already touched. And what are they putting it in the form of? The pain in the form of words. Word by word, they bind it in the form of a stone. And that stone, this costly stone, is dressed, is hidden, is covered in the form of poetry. You cannot understand the pain of the writer in the way the writer has. Maybe this is why he's able to write such a beautiful poem that you're supposed to read, or that you are reading, or that you have read, any which way. Right? So this is what the writer here is trying to talk about. These lines are the core. These lines are the core lines of this entire passage. If you don't understand the last lines, again, it's a separation of idea. If you don't understand the last lines, again, you'll get stuck. Not only it talks about the pain, but it talks about the pain in relation to the poets who put out their pain in the form of these words, binding their words word by word, just like a necklace, you know, just like pearl by pearl, pearl by pearl, and then you have a necklace in front of you, so beautiful, but carved so painfully. Okay, all these beautiful necklaces that these women wear. So how does that happen? Maybe you see that it's so beautiful, but you don't know the amount of pain that is imbibed, or that was imbibed when somebody maybe made it with their hard work. So this poem has the pain. This poem of the poet has all the pain of the world. And you see these words, word by word, binding all of them together. And that stone in front of you, that necklace in front of you, dressed, hidden, covered all together. And you cannot see it the way the poet saw it. Right? Understood? Okay, coming back, let's look at the questions. We have question number 12. It says, the writer shows here that joy and sadness are identical to each other. I do agree. This can be the right answer. But let's try looking at all the options. Melancholy is the attunement of the spirit and is essential related to the poetic word. Theek hai? Okay. Melancholy is depressive and burdensome, and the poetic words symptomatically discloses it. Okay, but not that okay. All of the above? No, not at all. We'll try analyzing A and B, because you know a lot of students will get confused here. A lot of students will mark A because they'll read the first line, that is, but more joyful the joy, the more pure the sadness slumbering within it. A lot of students will think that this will be the right answer, but no, I've already discussed it with you, given you a big lecture on it, that these lines are the core lines of this passage, where he's talking about what? The jewel which arrays it in the precious relation to the word, and with this raiment shelters it. So melancholy is what? It's the attunement of the spirit and is essentially related to poetic word. Poetic word. This is the core essence of the passage. Theek hai? Understood? Now coming back to question number 13. The writer here offers a psychoanalytic theory of melancholy. Oh my god, not at all. All of my students who have studied psychoanalytical theory with me will be able to identify that this is an absolute wrong answer. If you have marked this, I'll give you a big slap. Okay, of course this cannot be the right answer. Option number A is absolutely wrong. Psychoanalytic theory does not fit in here at all. Psychiatric clinical analysis of depression, such a funny option, not at all. A sociological historical description of pain. Now they're talking about pain in such a personal context. Sociological historical doesn't fit in at all. So I'll go with none of the above. None of the above is the right answer, because you see, in the entire passage, the poet is trying to talk about, or the writer is trying to talk about, the soul and soul in relation to the pain, or spirit and soul in relation to the pain. So none of the options are talking about that, or none of the options are talking about soul and sadness in relation to the poetic word. So we're not going to mark any of these answers or any of these options. We're going to check mark option number D, because this is the absolute ultimate option. You cannot fit in a better option than this. So yeah, there should be no confusion. Okay, no confusion after what we have done with the passage now. Question number 14. Melancholy here is understood as a psychological state of depressive individual. No, not at all. Here they're talking about melancholy. A spiritual, mystical union of human beings with God. Oh my god, theek hai, please never mark this answer, because they're talking about spiritual, mystical union of human beings with God. So when you finally unite with God, that union never results in melancholy. If you think that, you know, it results in melancholy, please forget that. Theek hai? Option number B is absolutely wrong. Not even in your dreams. If you are able to, you know, spiritually connect with God, in any case, it's going to give you the happiness of the world. And melancholy is an absolute opposite thing to the spiritual mystical union with the God. So no, not at all. Option number B is absolutely wrong. An existential attunement of the mortal with the word. Oh my god, you cannot fit in a better answer than this. An existential attunement of the mortal with the world. See why? Now you have to apply your literary sense again here. Apply a little sense. an existential. Existential is what? When you don't know what you are. Okay, complete absurdity of your life. Existential. Now, if you don't know what existential is, I'm sorry, this is a basic literature thing. Existential attunement of the mortal with the world. Wherever world is, wherever materialism is, what is there? Pain is there, right? Melancholy is there. Sadness is there. All those things are there that the writer was talking about there in the passage above, right? So in any case, this is going to be the right answer. I know a lot of students will do what? They will mark option number A. But why will option number A exist when you have the already, you have the existence of an option like C? Why will option number A exist when you have an option like C? Okay, look at the options first of all. Look at the options carefully. Try identifying your options. Try studying your options carefully first. If you have the word, you already have the word, a word like existential here that already defines the very state, the very existence of melancholy. If you have pain in your life, it's only because you're living in this world. If you have corona in this life, it's only because you're living in this world. In any case, it's not going to be, melancholy will not result in your spiritual union with God. Right? So, number one, they're also using the word existential. They're also using a word like world. So, existential, world and melancholy, all of these words, they go together, hand in hand. So, in any case, option number C is the best absolute answer here. Right, so enough done. If you guys want to watch other questions also, because I'll be taking all of the questions, I'll be solving complete question paper of JNU's 2019 JNU's question paper. I'll be solving the complete question paper. Stay tuned for other videos. I'll be posting my links down there of my previous videos. Check out those. Try studying the basics of the PG entrances. Try studying the sample question that I have given you guys in my previous video. Try looking for all of those things and then come back to this video, and wait for the other video. I'll be solving all of these questions, so stay tuned for the next video. I'll be coming out with the next video really soon for you all. So take care.